that I think the comments that have been made are correct. And in fact, I have been updating what's been happening around the state, and there have been a few new actions that have been taken, including what was referenced by the public commentator, that the president of the PUC has directed PG&E to come up with an alternative for an opt-out provision within 2 weeks. It's a little bit unclear to me right now whether that's actually a formal action by the PUC. So I'm trying to research that, and I will provide a written memo to the council within the next week on
that. Thank you. All right. With that, we will go ahead and proceed to the consent calendar, six items on the consent calendar, two items on the redevelopment agency consent calendar. Would any member of council like an item pulled for separate discussion?
Sure. Item three.
Okay.
Item six. No questions.
Okay. Anyone else to my right? Public. Is that a one or a six? That's a six. Okay.
Item six.
Okay. Anyone else? All right. We're going to go ahead and do five and six first. So we will go five, six, and three. We'll start with the public.
Number five is financials for January. In all the categories, we're doing reasonably okay. Building stuff is still down a bit, but I am encouraged by the numbers are coming in pretty much as projected, and you're getting some stimulus money and some other monies that you guys are doing pretty good at getting the money from the trough, and some of that's showing up. So that's good news. And if you don't mind, I'll go into six.
No, go ahead. We'll just stay with you. Yeah, go ahead.
And then on six. Retirement savings can be neutral if you evaluate it against terminating employees, but you're down to 542 and a half employees. As I told you earlier, I think we should be up at 700 to really get the services that we need in the community. You can't take it down below 540 to balance your $7 million budget. So I'm not sure that it's a really fair. You know, hopefully you're not going to be terminating. So it is going to be an additional cost. But then again, if it causes a lot of high-end people to get out, and if you bring people in at step one, you will have savings. So, okay. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. All right, Sergio, why don't we go to six, your questions?
Just a quick comment and questions. I'll do my questions first. Just wondering from staff, what has been the method of communicating with employee groups in regards to offering this incentive?
Well, my response would be is that this is a direct response to the employee's request. I start receiving requests, you know, probably as early as January. Employees asking, one, if we were going to have the opportunity for retired employees to retire early. Retirement age employees to retire early, and also whether or not we could extend it to non-retirement age employees to participate. And so this is in direct response to employees wanting to see this come forward sooner than later, because as you know, on the 29th, we will be presenting to the council a list of positions that will possibly be on the chart for layoffs. And so employees want to have the opportunity to resign before that list comes out.
I appreciate that, but my question was very specific about what process have we taken to communicate this with employee organizations, not individual employees. So it's a significant item, and it's a significant, I'm not disagreeing in what we're doing. I just want to understand what the process was to communicate. Groups that are represented, we don't negotiate directly with employees. Groups that are represented, we negotiate through their representatives. I'm asking specifically what has been that process.
We've talked with the police groups during negotiations about this, with the fire groups during negotiations about this. We're meeting with the union presidents of the non-safety groups tomorrow at 10, we'll be talking about this.
So what response have we gotten from the ones that we have talked to?
It's positive.
Okay.
Yeah.
So positive. What do we, I mean, it just seems to me that it's premature that we're voting on something on consent agenda on an item that people should have had an opportunity to discuss and give us feedback. I'm just a little concerned of supporting something on consent agenda that has not thoroughly been vetted with the different employee groups. I don't understand why we didn't do that.
I think the reason why we put it on consent calendar is because it's basically the same program that you had last year, and so we decided that since it wasn't that big of a change, that we would put it on the consent calendar. It's not a new item to the city council nor to employees.
Yeah, we are expanding it to the entire workforce, so it is significant. So we have not vetted with every single employee group out there. We only discussed with some.
At this point, yes.
Okay, so what's the urgency of having it today? Again, I'm not disagreeing what we're doing. I'm just process-wise, what's the urgency of today?
To open the window to start let employees start planning if they're interested in this. I think it's all on the upside, the positive side. I really have not heard anything negative.
All right.
I don't think there is a downside.
So my comment is hopefully people will take advantage of it, those that would want to retire and want to retire, and then they can do that. I think it'd be good for this council to get an update on how much it's costing and have an ongoing tally how many people are actually retiring, because it might be that people don't take the offer and say it's not the right time to be unemployed. So just want to make sure this council continues to get constant information, because it is significant, and hopefully a lot of folks will take advantage of it. They want to, but so I appreciate getting creative in doing this and expanding to the rest of the group. I think we had a pretty good response the last time. My only last comment is, when we do this kind of stuff, I'd rather not see it in consent agenda. I'd rather not have not employee, you should actually have in your report that says employee groups have been contacted and this is the responses. At least this councilman would appreciate that, just because we have an obligation to discuss and to share information with people, and I think that should be included. And for the future, I think that would be appropriate. Thank you.
Thank you, Sergio. Jill?
I think part of a bit of confusion that I had a little bit was not realizing that this was coming to the council, but so be it. I'm delighted that we are having this opportunity to offer this again this year. And I think, Tom, it might be a good idea if you could maybe go over the figures, how many employees took advantage of the program last year, realizing that it certainly can't be replicated this year, but at least let the public understand why this was such a beneficial program that we offered last year.
Okay. In last year, 2010, we had 39 employees retire under the 24-month health program. That worked out to be an average cost per employee of $18,600. That same time frame, we had to lay off 43 employees, including costs associated with up to 6 weeks severance pay, 18 months health, which is already provided to a laid off employee, and unemployment costs. The average cost per those 43 employees was $30,800. So it's a significant savings for those employees that would choose to just retire or resign under the incentive program. It's a savings of up to 40% versus having to lay off an employee.
Yeah.
Okay, Steve, did you have something?
Okay. Mr. Mayor, I have someone. Is that?
Sorry, okay. Tony?
Mr. Mayor, this is for the city manager. So on March 29th, is that when the employees are going to know whether they're getting laid off? Is that when they're getting their pink slips?
We will be communicating with the employees well in advance of that date. That's when we'll go publicly, but all the employees will have been talked to before the 29th.
Before the 29th? Do we know what, no specific day?
Vanessa was just clarifying, while we will have a public item on the 29th, we will be giving notices to the employees after the council approves publicly those positions to be identified as possible positions to be laid off.
So this is after the city council meeting?
Right.
All right, thank you.
But keep in mind, too, we will be sharing with them. I believe, Tom, is the plan to share with them ahead of time the... So we didn't want to have employees surprised at a public meeting to find out their position was on the layoff list. So we do plan on communicating with them in advance as well.
So that's what I'm asking. Do we know what day we're going to start doing that?
Next week. Possibly Wednesday. We were going to talk about that further at our director's meeting on Tuesday, but it's going to be before the staff report goes out.
Okay. All right. Anyone else from the public? Brett was his own segue. Then we went to council. We will now proceed out to public. So anyone from the public on item 6?
Can I ask what that means, that Brett was his own segue?
He asked to comment on both 5 and 6. I allowed him to do that rather than proceed to 6, went to council, and now proceeding out to public on 6.
Okay.
That was a courtesy I was happy to extend.
I was going to ask for a point of order, but I saw what happened the last time.
You're using up your time, Joe.
That's fine. Is a point of order out of order? When I was in high school in Future Farmers and we took parliamentary procedure, point of order was a civil way of bringing a point to a public body. Could I get a clarification of that from the city attorney?
Joe, if you have a comment on item 6, I suggest you proceed.
You think I'm playing with you? I'm not. This is a legitimate question I'm asking.
We don't answer questions from the dais in a dialogue forum. We set them aside and deal with them later.
In the Future Farmers,
have any comment on
during parliamentary procedure, we called for a point of order.
And I have the latitude to run the meeting. Okay. Anyone else from the public?
Under the law.
Anyone else from the public? Okay, we're going to come back to... all right, before we proceed to item 3, I'm going to go ahead and see if there's a motions for 1, 2, 3.
Move approval.
Second.
Okay. Patty, call for the question. So this is for 1, 2, 3, 4, or 1, 2, 4, 5, and 6.
And the redevelopment.
Correct.
Yes.
And the redevelopment agency. So.
Councilmember Craig?
I apologize. Can you repeat? Sorry, I was in discussion.
We're voting on whether or not to approve items 1, 2, 4, 5, and 6 for the consent calendar, and 1 and 2 on redevelopment.
Thank you. Aye.
Councilmember Barrera?
Aye.
Councilmember Lutz?
Aye.
Councilmember McShane?
Aye.
Councilmember Sanchez?
Yes.
Mayor Donahue?
Yes. Okay. All right. Item 3, and if it's been a while, but I think, Steve, you pulled 3, correct?
Correct.
Okay.
Okay. Just want to start by making it clear that my discussion on this item is not related to Abbott Place or Abbott Street, just 109 Catherine. This is, as I understand it, the second part of a two-part process to rezone 109 Catherine from low-density residential to commercial office. Two points to be made. One, the neighbors in the surrounding area are very uncomfortable with this. That's why it's back, kind of as an item to talk about. Secondly, as I shared last week, this is a classic example of commercial creep down a residential street. And for those on the south side, they know that Catherine Avenue has some sympathy. There's a lot of issues associated with that street over the years. And being so close to some of the other commercial, you'll hear tonight some of the issues that they have. The council voted last week and started us down a path to move towards allowing this reclassification. And, you know, I understand that once the decision's made, we got to stand behind it. But procedurally, as I understand it, in order to proceed with what the constituents have asked for, and that is to look at this once again and ask for additional time for evaluation, the way to go about it would either be reconsidering, which would have to come from one of the other council members after the vote on this matter takes place, that voted for the item.